her PhDs on the role and emergence of radical black student intellectuals. And the paper that she'll be talking to today is called Forget Transformation, Roads Must Fall, and the Decolonization of the University. So we're very pleased to have you here. Thanks very much for coming here. You're busy, and I'm glad you could make it. So the normal format is half an hour presentation, and we have more than enough time to talk later. That's it. Thanks a lot.
Hi everyone, thanks so much for hosting me in this crazy time, especially in the Western Cape at the moment. I think the pendulum between where the action is swinging between, at the moment, the University of Johannesburg and the University of Cape Town. I'm very happy that Vince has at least calmed down for a little bit, so it's possible for me to be here with you. Maybe just to say that I understand that we all are in the middle of this because we are at universities, and so we've been watching what's been going on in other places, and also obviously have a lot of experience in what's going on at your institution. This particular paper comes out of largely the first month and a bit of the Roads Must Fall student movement, which is March, April of this year. And so there'll be a lot of probably questions around the now that won't be covered in this particular paper, but I'm very happy to, in conversation later, to speak to those things if there are specific questions. So the PowerPoint is more just to give images of some of the things I'll be talking to. So I'm going to read because otherwise I'll just go off on a tangent because there's so much going on at the moment. So also just to say, I've included in the introduction just a little bit that points to the VIT situation, but obviously that's because I'm at that situation, I mean, that's my context, and it does highlight some of the fact that what RMF was going through, or UCT was going through a few months ago, has been kind of popping up all over in different institutions. So, and one last apology, if you read the Sunday Independent, there's a very short version of this in the Independent. I'm hoping you guys didn't read it. So in response to non-violent protests by thousands of its students in the first week of the Fees Must Fall campaign, on a principle issue, just pick up a little bit. Okay, I'll speak up. So in response to non-violent protests by thousands of its students in the first week of the Fees Must Fall campaign, on a principal issue of access to education, this notice was put up on WITS campus. It invokes the Trespass Act of 1959 to criminalize students' use of university space to express their grievances and protest unfair fee hikes at the university. After an outcry from the broader WITS community, the university withdrew these notices, claiming unofficially it was a bad decision by the Vice-Chancellor, who was standing in while the WITS Vice-Chancellor attended the Department of Higher Education and Training Transformation Summit. A week or so later, the university was again using the 1959 Act to force an end to the protest and the demands of the student movement at this university. 1959 was quite a year. It was the year that a decade of national party rule culminated in a slew of new legal mechanisms to entrench the racial project of unequal and separate development. The 1959 Prisons Act, for example, which consolidated the prison as a key means of state repression. The 1959 Promotion of Bantu Self-Government Act, establishing the Homeland System. The 1959 Extension of University Act, Education Act, which enforced racial segregation in higher education and established the Bush Colleges. So in WITS University's invocation of the 1959 Trespass Act twice in the last month, WITS senior management right, and I quote, "The university exercises its rights as the owner and lawful occupier of the university's property, hereby revokes its permission for any person who blockades entrances and exits, blocks lifts and stairwells, etc., to enter or to be present on the university property. Anybody engaged in the activities identified above does so contrary to the express instructions of the university and acts without the permission of the university," end quote. The question we need to ask here is, who is this university? and in whose name is it assuming these statements? In whose name is it invoking the 1959 rule? We've seen with incredible regularity over the past year how senior management at our universities have used the name of our universities to criminalize and marginalize students. They've brought down the force of disciplinary procedures on the most vital politics, some of the most valuable resources at our institution, that our institution has seen in decades. It's precisely this resource, a new student movement, that has shown itself not only to lead on principled issues of university transformation, but also to lead on the implementation that is being squandered by managements that misrecognize their worth and defensively justify apartheid-era disciplinary action. At the University of Johannesburg just a few days ago, 141, mostly workers, but also students and academics from the University of Johannesburg and a few from the Wits University were arrested while peacefully protesting against the deal signed between the university management and NAU, which is one of the unions, with regards to the in-principle agreement of insourcing. UJ currently has three interdicts taken up against students, one of which has been taken up for the first time by an outsourced company against its own workers. This while UCT and later Wits, and I think Stellenbosch as well, have recently withdrawn the interdicts they held as part of the continued negotiations with student movements at these campuses, which included outsourced workers. So I've been researching the RMF movement since it began in March this year, and tracking alongside it the emergence of the new student movement at universities across the country. I was fortunate enough to be a participant observer of the Rosemary Fall movement from when the shit hit the statue on the 9th of March. I watched from afar at first, as many of us did, YouTube videos, reading the opinion pieces, reports on the event, and social media conversations, and varying reactions and repercussions of this event. A participant observed more closely from the time of the first occupation of the management's Bremner building, more fondly known to some as the Zanya House. In addition to my participant observation, I've also done in-depth interviews with 15 RMF participants who were actively involved in the occupation and the broader movement, and then I did some follow-up focus groups with some of the interviews. So I'll attempt today to recontextualize some of the RMF activities as creative pedagogical processes, and do so by unpacking these processes into critical tasks, which form the basis of understanding the significance of this movement and moment in the South African political transition. The RMF movement has gifted us with a radical praxis internal to the university that has insisted that the age-old questions of power, privilege, and oppression be addressed in relation to all the facets of the university, such that critical conversation is able to be accessed by ordinarily marginalized members of the university community. Importantly, it has challenged traditional understandings of curriculum, knowledge, and pedagogy. They did this in a number of ways, too many to discuss now, so I'll focus on the educational program. Let me start with a quote from a black RMF student originally from the Eastern Cape when asked about his initial experience of UCT. And I quote, "I felt the horror and the alienation because I wanted to belong. You know, you want to get into the spirit of being a UCT student, and you know UCT is the best in Africa and the best in the country, so you come. You bring yourself because you're in this process of creating the best you can. And so you come into this institution and you met with this alienation. And then you reorient. Now you have to deal in this way that you didn't expect." And I think that white students don't get that. They're here to create the best selves, and they go because the institution enables that. The institutional cultures are really suited for them. They don't have to navigate it. It's just there for them for the taking. That's what. So the stories of black RMF students are different depending on their lived experience and position in relation to varying privileges. A student from Khayelitsha's version is different to a St. John's private school graduate. It's different to the person who spent most of their life growing up in exile and then returning to South Africa from university. But the common disturbing thread was, we are alien, we are other. The norm at UCT revolves around what the movement have identified as white supremacist, capitalist, and heteropatriarchal. The shit hitting the statue on the 9th of March was a catalyst for the refusal by many black students to continue to hold and hide this alienation. Black students before RMF were already creating alternate spaces where they were sharing these lived experiences and feelings with one another. Some of these initiatives were formalized and became regular opportunities to connect, and recognize each other's painful experiences of alienation. But these were also spaces where people were reading and discussing writings that spoke more to Black experiences, analyses of oppression, and questions of decolonization and revolution. These spaces were the beginnings of alienating the alienation and disrupting the normative by making it strange. So a critical task of decolonization then is recognizing that there's a dominant norm and that there are many students and staff, admin support and academic, who experience being excluded from this norm. Another critical task of decolonization is the difficult and scary process of disrupting the existing norms. This is a picture of that council meeting where they're going to make the decision about whether to move the statue or not. So this disruption at UCT took on many forms. The Kimani Fleming Pool, the much publicized disruption of the previously sacred council meeting, to the exposing of UCT's implication and silence around the Marikana massacre, and highlighting the hypocrisy of UCT hosting Piketty to speak on inequality in South Africa when it continues to engage in outsourcing workers and refuses to hear students speak of inequality on the very campus. So this was the Marikana event. This was disrupting the Thomas Piketty event. So the hijackings of meetings, panels, and other platforms created and used by UCT management also started challenging the hierarchies of the university structure and calling out the impotent bureaucratic processes that stand in for and exhaust any radical attempts to affect change. The message conveyed by these hijackings were, you are not in charge of us, you are not able to lead on these issues, your process is corrupt and vacuous, and therefore you do not tell us what to do and how to do it anymore. This was read by the media and fearful, mostly but not exclusively white people, in the UCT fraternity as barbaric, uncouth and unproductive behavior, which focused attention on these constitutive acts as misguided and inappropriate techniques. This perspective missed that disruption was an essential part of Black students and staff creating a space for themselves to believe, while also creating alternate platforms and spaces, learning and teaching spaces with much more porous boundaries to start decolonizing UCT. So the deepening of consciousness, followed by the hijacking, refusing and rendering corrupt of the official management control process of transformation, was necessary for a new space to be created. In these acts of refusal, disruption, destruction, RMF turned the whole campus, including public spaces and platforms, into a pedagogical arena, extending the classroom boundary. They made more explicit the lived experience of Black students and staff on campus and called out the silent and implicit privileging of the white heterosexual male, middle-class, able-bodied norm by coming up with creative and interesting opportunities for conscientization or learning for themselves, but also for the broader UCT and Cape Town public. So another critical task of decolonization then could be seen as the sometimes individual, but more often the collective conscientization of teaching learning, by creating alternate spaces and expanding the boundaries of the classroom, taking learning into broader life, and as you will see a bit later, bringing life into the more traditional classroom space. Again, there are many examples of this, but I'll discuss one briefly, which was known as the Sarki Bartman performance. A small group of RMF students painted themselves black. They wore only white loincloth and chains, and they walked that way in silence to where the Bartman statue stands. They performed the piece and then published a written reflection on the performance. Here I will let one of the performer teachers explain, quote, "We reject her presentation in the library. We reject that her standing naked commemorates her and retains her dignity. Further, we see no difference in the racist, sexist methods used by the French and British in the freak show attraction and her presentation in the UCT Oppenheimer Library. Thus, we aim to illustrate that the violent objectification and sexualization of the black body is a system which feeds into the stereotype of racial superiority so subtly and insidiously that it is hard to detect even by those bodies it represents in real life. So our aim is to challenge a history that represents us as a fetish, as base sexual beings. There are particular ways in which Sarki Bartman's spirit and legacy can be contextualized and respected. Thus, in our climatic end, we draped her and covered her, hoping to show that these violences inflicted on the black body and psychology still continue, and we will not stop until we decolonize the black body and mind End quote. So another example of such a teaching learning experience was when individual RMF members sat on single chairs placed in various public spaces on campus facing an empty chair. They invited students and passers-by to sit down and ask them questions about RMF and what was going on. The performer teachers reflected that they were surprised by how many people took the time to sit down, how little people actually knew about what was going on, and the intensity of the engagement that ensued. These experiments or new versions of teach-ins became a significant contribution to the educational landscape of UCT. Black students were leading the educational process of making meaning about situations, contexts, histories, symbols, and so on. So this leads to the next critical task, which is about reimagining the relation between student and teaching. And this is a picture of one of the sessions that were going on in Zanya House in the Mafeji room. And you can see Pumla Tola there sitting as part of, rather than necessarily at the front of the conversation. So who is the architect of the classroom space and who commands the authority and responsibility to teach and learn? Here what I'm also talking about was the experimentation with this by RMF occupying the management building and renaming it as Zanya House, and then taking over leadership of the decolonization of the university. Again, there are many examples that currently lay uninvestigated by that radically transformative experiment and process. Many of the people who are fortunate enough to be part of making and remaking a Zanya House will attest to its significance in their own learning, often through discomfort and challenge, two very important things that many agree are imperative for learning and shifts in consciousness. So let me speak briefly about one part of the RMF movement that I was particularly interested in, the Education Subcommittee, which was one of the first to be formed on the 17th of March, prior to the occupation taking place. RMF formed a dozen or so subcommittees, which were working groups that arose out of the need to engage particular questions and issues, from writing subcommittees to media to education, logistics, and so on. These were made up of students who volunteered to think through various parts of what needed to happen in order for the movement to successfully enact changes it understood as necessary for decolonizing UCT. Each of these subcommittees had their own meetings and processes, but they were all linked to the workings of the other subcoms, and the chairs of each subcom formed what was called a strategic committee. During the three-week occupation, these subcommittees met to discuss, analyze, and think critically, and then come up with suggested implications and actions of the learnings. This radical practice of searching again, or researching, reading, thinking, questioning through critical conversation, as well as principled action, formed part of the daily lives of permanent occupiers, as well as people coming in more sporadically, and is potentially another critical task. So the education subcommittee set about researching, discussing, and planning a number of things, one of the most important of which was organizing a nightly seminar at the Zanya House. These seminars were open to the public and drew up to 200 people per event, often more. The form of the events differed from the usual university classroom space, even as it also engaged with some of the techniques and methods of traditional classroom. Black intellectuals were invited by the education subcommittee to give inputs varying from 40 to 90 minute lectures, followed by Q&A, PowerPoint presentations, viewing of interesting films, followed by discussion, and so on. As we all know, form and content are virtually inseparable and very important parts of the pedagogy. It was an explicit selection of speakers and content by the education subcom, which again came out of the commitment to Black consciousness and Pan-Africanism, and ensured a centering or focus on Black lived experience. As mentioned earlier, the basic forms of the RMF educational space were not all new forms of teaching learning and classroom structure. There were clearly educational forms outside of the traditional classroom or seminar space that were creative and innovative, as described, for example, with the Bachman performance. But if you look closer at the nightly seminar also, and those who attended can attest, there were more than just the familiar normative forms. In fact, also more than just the familiar content. So the education subcom led the ongoing discussion and development, another critical task, of a form or a frame for the educational space in the critical conversation that now be contained, that took seriously the lived experience of Black students and the imbalance of power at relations at UCT, connecting the classroom to the university and society, but also importantly, in Fanon's words, putting the last first. There was an explicit centering of this lived experience named as black pain in all of the discussions and workings of RMF, which became more thought through and practiced every day. Each discussion, be it in the seminar series, the subcommittees, the general assemblies, even the interactions in the communal and social spaces at the Zanya House, took seriously this practice, understood further as a three-part frame made up of the philosophy, concepts, and political practice of black consciousness and Pan-Africanism, with a methodology that revolved around the idea or concept of black feminist intersectionality. What this meant in practice was that the more structured seminar space and form was dealing with different kinds of content. Firstly, an engagement with the content that was being presented by a speaker or a teacher or a specialist on a particular topic. Secondly, the content created by reflecting on the way the critical conversation was unfolding, whose voices were being sent to which people, but also which narratives or norms were being verbalized and centered, and what was being silenced. Thirdly, the ongoing content or linking of content from the occupation, in other words, discussions about how, for example, gender norms were dictated problematically, who cleaned and fed, and how the bathroom signage made certain people feel excluded and unwelcome. Also, what it meant to try and have critical conversations about particular things in the presence of white people who are unconscious of the power and privilege they carry in conversations, and the effect that this has on others' ability to engage. What it meant to have men who were vigilant to the power and oppression of white people, or racism in the conversation, and blind to the power of oppression and men or patriarchy in the conversation. So I'll end by saying that these processes I'm sharing with you were messy, complicated, and difficult, but the experiments and mistakes were made through an attempt at conscious radical praxis. The continual reflections on and practice of a new form of engagement was the basis for huge learning for many involved, including the people making the mistakes, and could be considered as another critical task. So the form or structure of the conversation taking place in all these fora included criticality based on reading, but importantly also based on action and the practice of the radical concepts that RMF were engaging with. It was a risking and a vulnerability that young students were willing to engage in, a surfacing of their not knowing, as they honored that they also did know many things based on their intimacy with the ideas being engaged. So at the core of these urgent critical tasks were students experimenting with the radical content and new forms of engagement, which understand the everyday life of the university as the basis for decolonization. In these critical conversations, they were foregrounding the relation between intimacy, affect, danger, ambivalence, and knowledge, the relation between these concepts with radical content and new forms of engagement is a productive space to continue the conversation about decolonization and its extension beyond UCT and RMF. We really need to recognize the politics and struggle of students as valid and valuable, and we need to learn from the leadership of students in the student movement at the moment.
Thanks very much.
Okay, what we could do is take three or four questions at a time.
Yeah,
all right. And yeah, we can respond to that. So, and could you just mention your name?
Yeah, quick.
Anybody for comments or questions?
Also, reflections on what's going on here as a way into the
conversation.
are thinking.
This is solid, and then others will follow.
My name's Nathan. I just have it's a very interesting dichotomy that always exists between Stellenbosch and UCT spaces. And it's always very easy for white students at UCT to go, oh, I go to Stellenbosch. But then, obviously, this is actually a brilliant presentation on actually RMF and the space of RMF actually curated. This has been actually amazing, but how would this reflect upon in a Stellenbosch environment? There's some critiques, there's some recognition that OAS has to play to a very different environment, so what actually relates these people to Stellenbosch environment, what they did is quite amazing. There's other critiques that they should be a lot more radical. There's other critiques that should be a lot more soft. What are your reflections on this space?
I've heard a lot of those critiques from various people. So everyone has an opinion, which I think is a very good starting point. You actually have students and people who are talking about what's going on campus a lot in the West. We've seen in a while. I can't speak specifically to Stellenbosch, but let me just give an example of Wits University, which is where I'm from. A lot of people assume that because Wits demographically had changed, so we have a majority black student populace, even as our staff is not as transformed. And people were worried about how this would mean that students would organize themselves. So we don't, our student movement, originally there was something called Transform Wits, which was actually a precursor to RMF. It was a group of politics students who sent a memorandum to the department in November of last year, saying this is why we believe this department is problematic and we need to look at curriculum, and the idea of decolonization came up in that form. And it was a very small group of people, and then RMF happened, and there was kind of a bounce back to Wits going like, what are we going to do? Where's our student movement? But at that point, our student movement was actually not, and when I say student movement, I don't mean SRC movement, I mean outside of SRC. the gathering of students leading by alliance between workers and progressive academics. So it was a difficult situation at Wits because in some way certain people wanted to replicate what was going on at UCT. So we had conversations with a broad alliance of people who'd been working on questions of outsourcing for 10 years, some of the staff, academic staff. We had the politics students who had this memorandum that they handed over, and then we had the SRC and this new Fees Must Fall campaign. And the challenge was that when we were having conversation about how we could organize more collectively and get more students involved, certain people wanted to replicate what was going on at UCT. So people wanted to say, how are we centering black pain here? And the context was different, slightly different, and the people in the room were slightly different with different histories. So for example, it's much easier at the UCT, in my humble opinion, to say that academics are getting people down. It's a harder thing to say at Wits because we have academics who've been imprisoned, who stand with students when the police are attacking, who are in meetings consistently, not just about curriculum, about outsourcing, etc. So what I'm trying to say is that the context at every university is different. So I wouldn't be able to speak specifically about the era. But if I were to speak about some of the lessons that came out of this moment in RMF, was that they really took seriously the fact that education and reflection, critically thinking about what one was doing, was imperative in forwarding the struggles of the movement itself. So there wasn't a separation between the action of struggle and marching, etc., and the necessity of reading, having conversations, listening to people's opinions. So those two things were happening, in my opinion, at this point in the movement, much more consciously and frequently. Of course, that changed in relation to when the occupation ended, what management did in response to the movement, who was having disciplinary hearings, etc., etc. So maybe you can, or someone here can reflect more on what happened with the Open Stellenbosch case, but my work is in particular trying to look at what the education programs, how are movements structuring their thinking and talking with each other such that it informs what the political program, if you want to call it, the action program is.
Thanks. Okay, let's go on to... Could you please introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Naim Dhali. My claim to fame is that I knew Leanne as a child. I have a number of questions. But I'd like to, my questions are mostly related to what is going on now. Fees question and exercise. So before I ask those specific questions, I'd like you just to talk a little bit about what your take is around fees and insourcing now.
Okay, can I answer that? So, a lot of people are claiming, and depending on one's position, that he's either in an SOC or union or council or senate, who are trying to claim these campaigns. I would call them campaigns. If you look closely at what RMF, for example, wrote, have the initial statement of all their demands, you'll find all of this in there. And so the question around fees for me, if you look at how students have organized over the last decade or more, at the beginning of every year, fees is an issue, and you can mobilize lots of people around it, and this has happened historically at most universities, I think. In terms of insourcing, outsourcing, since 1999, I think at first, from 2000, there was already a resistance to outsourcing. And there's been a continued struggle that staff had maintained with workers, academic staff and workers, and then students have come in and out as they've been at the, so we have a workers solidarity committee at UCT, they have the left student forum or something. So my reason for saying that is that I think those two campaigns form part of a broader, what I would hope to think is a gaining student movement. That have been happening at individual universities for a long time, years. How, in my opinion, we ended up with what we did a month ago was I don't know if it was the first attempt, but it was an attempt coming out of Rhodes Must Fall, and then various universities' responses to seeing what was possible at UCT. A connecting of these student movements. And some of you might have seen the October 6 campaign, or the October 6 movement, as it's called, which was an attempt between Wits and the University of Johannesburg had been meeting since June, led by students, but academic staff and workers, around what the student movement is, what is this decolonizing the university, what does it mean to use it. So there was a conversation between the University of Johannesburg and Wits, and there was a sense that what needed to happen was that people needed to stop talking about all the concepts and they needed some kind of praxis. And that's where people came up with the date of October 6th. There's no other significance. And leading up to that, the attempt was to say, let's go to the student movements outside of resources and unions that exist, and let's try and connect this struggle. If people are truly speaking about decolonization, as opposed to the transformation agenda. And when that happened, UCT, Open Stellenbosch, the Black Student Movement, those were the main ones, joined and decided to do a national action on October 6th around outsourcing. What had also happened was that there was this march, the anti-corruption march, and there was an attempt to have a national strike. That national strike was delayed because of legal processes to Wednesday, the 14th of October. Our SOC some of them were part of the conversations of October 6th because they're part of the Workers' Solidarity Committee, etc., had come into a meeting that was reflecting on October 6th, on October 7th, and said, we've gone to council and we've fought our council, we don't want a 12% increase. All these guys have said this will give you 11.5 for the next year. Can we please focus the energy now on fees while we keep the energy and the campaign and the purpose around insourcing? I mean, that's a shorter version of, and that's how, in my mind, the Wednesday, the 14th of October became this big day, and further connections were made then through SASCO and the SRCs around the call to that particular day. So, I mean, that is just my take on those two things. To say a little bit more, people have asked this question, is this a 1976 moment? Someone had a poster and now everyone's saying this is 76 because there's lots of students on the street. In my mind, it's probably more akin to a 1968-1969 moment where you've just come out of a decade of, in 60 you have the ANC and the PSC banned, you have student movements inclined towards the new unity movement, the ANC and the PAC in varying forms in the early 60s. Then you have repression and the student movements collapse. And then there's this gap that happens. And by 68, 69, you have black students saying, we can't find a voice in USAS. It's too white and it doesn't listen to our agenda. Therefore, we need Black consciousness, we need to break away and develop our own student movement, our own voice, such that we can critique. If you look at what was going on at RMF and in many campuses now, that's what's happening. Black students are saying, we need to look out for ourselves, we need to center what's going on for us, we need to call out this norm, etc., etc. So I think it's more akin to a 68 moment of not only black consciousness in terms of self-reflection and one's individual consciousness, but also a call to Pan-Africanism. The idea that we need to be reading Fanon and Lumumba and all the Pan-African canon as opposed to, and then the new 2015 thing is of course that this intersectionality, which just throws a whole spanner in the works because people ask the question, how can you even put those three things together in a room and try and have a conversation? And that's what some of the student movements have been starting with.
Is that
no? Yeah,
if you have something else you
want to do. Yes, I do, yeah. But I think I want to give someone else an opportunity.
Let me introduce Bernard, this department. Thanks for a very stimulating talk. I'm curious about whether you could tease out a little more explicitly the forget transformation part of your title. And I ask that partly because of questions of context. I mean, in a way, some places have had a transformation discourse, some universities for a long time. And others, the discourse may have been there, but the question of how much transformation has actually happened is hanging over. And so I'm curious whether you think transformation should be abandoned entirely, whether it could still be mobilized as a tool given its sort of role in government and institutions and so on. So I want you to see that out. The second thing is, I'm curious about the role of SOC. Yeah, the relationship between SOCs at different places. I mean, you were speaking in the UJ in this context of SOCs being spaces in which solidarities were mobilized. At the same time, we know more recently that there's been tension between SOCs and Business Forward. At UWC, of course, in the last 10 days, there's been open conflict between, and you know, violent conflict between SOC and given especially that SOCs were established, I think, or were given a lot of power at some institutions after 1994, what are SOCs as representative structures? Must we abandon them? Does this moment suggest that we need to think about something else? Any other questions, comments?
Can I answer that one first? really, you just put your finger right into the... So firstly, this title I chose specifically because I did a similar talk at the Higher Education Summit. And there were all these government officials. And the night before, the minister agreed to meet with students who were there. So there were SOCs and political parties represented. And on the last minute, they included some of the student movement because people put them under pressure and said, what are you doing not including the student movements that have put this question back on the table? So in meeting, and I'm sorry, I like to tell things through this through stories, in meeting with the minister, which was very problematic because it was a reenactment of how you can't really speak to people, and these things are talk shops. So there were 450 people for this weekend with the panels up front, the tea breaks and the, you know, the normal conference type thing. On the first day, our SOC, but SOC presidents didn't come because, as you know, all hell broke loose. And Adam was on a plane, our vice chancellor was at the summit, and people were going, why is he here when things are kind of intense at his campus? So one of the RMF representatives got an email statement, one page from the SOC presidents that hadn't come. And they read this statement out as a way of bringing student voices into this plenary space that was quite sterile to what was going on. I mean, places were really. And the first thing that happened was that the person who was chairing was the director general of higher education, tried to shut them down and say, no, no, you're not in the program. What are you doing? And because RMF is used to disrupting and they're not listening to this, they're like, no, we're going to read this out. So there was this contention. And eventually, like 3-4 minutes before they finished their very important statement, the director general says, sorry, we're stopping you now, we're not going to allow this, and then goes, let's break for tea for 15 minutes. So that, literally, these were moments where you got the sense that the students were there and that this was a talk shop. So the students then rallied and said, we want to meet them and stuff because we think he must address us. He organizes a separate space for half an hour. But the rules of engagement is this. You caucus, you have two people come and present whatever your demands or questions are to the minister. The minister will then respond to you. No question and answer. This is not a meeting or a conversation. This is how it's going to happen if I call. So he pulls people aside. He gets into this room. He's got all his officials on the left and his VVIP security who jump into the conversation in many instances to shut people down when they were trying to ask questions. And I'm getting to your question on transformation. One of the things that he said stuck with me in that problematic exercise. The Sasco guys kept intervening and derailing what was going on. And saying, sorry for the Sasco people. This was just one guy. And I don't know Sasco well enough. Saying to his own reps who were standing up there giving the input, stop using this decolonization, this transformation. Okay, so that was happening from the floor. So of course, there's an ideological split in the movement. There's the ANC people who are wanting to talk about slow transformative processes. Some people would say surface level. Other people who are calling for decolonization are saying, no, the system is rotten. We can't just put black faces there. We need to change the system. So ideologically, interestingly, this puts, and the UWC situation is a key one, and I don't want to talk about, people have been telling me, don't talk about land. You're going to land yourself off of a list. Keep to like a concept. But that is ultimately what people are saying. We don't want slow transformation anymore. We want decolonization of the curriculum, of the university, but ultimately we want our land. And where this goes back to is the split between Sobukwe and Mandela. And people are not talking about it explicitly, but that's what's going on. So the reason why people are fighting each other at UWC is because of that question. So for me, I put transformation there because I think the people who are still talking about transformation are behind on times.
Yeah.
The consciousness of students is such that they understand this concept to be vacuous and about maintaining a status quo. So decolonization is there. I must say though, my own personal opinion is that decolonization is not far enough. Like people have been talking and thinking, and there's been a process of decolonization for a number of decades. We actually have to be creating new ways, as you were saying. But we can't even get to that because we're still struggling around this question of transformation and decolonization. So that's the first thing. The role of SRCs, and I think, I mean, I'm going to be bold, it's early now, but I'm going to be bold to say you can almost talk about senates, councils, and unions, even though they are very different institutions with different histories, in a similar vein. There's a way that top-down governance and democracy is being critiqued. There's a way that there's a lack of communication between, to use the union example at UCT, shop stewards or people in the negotiation and the people they're supposed to be representing. And so there is a move away from those structures. At WITS, we've managed to get to a negotiation on the insourcing issue in particular because we were very strategic about the task team, where we said we have 16 people on our task team. Outsourcing is a terrible, dehumanizing system that has been in existence for 1.5 decades. It's not going to take one three-hour meeting between Max Price and Nahalu to fix it in any significant way. So anyone who's presenting that as a solution to outsourcing is lying to people. So what WITS is doing is we've got two academics, two students from the student movement, four worker representatives of the biggest outsource companies, and one from the old student center, or these universities who leased out their student centers, and two people from council, two people from EXCO. And the thing that's holding everything up is the fact that the SRC wants to force themselves into this task team. And workers are clear at WITS that they don't want this to happen. Because as you say, in the beginning, there was an alliance between the outgoing SRC person, chairperson, who was part of October 6th, and the incoming chairperson, who not only will tell you straight to your face she's a deployee of the ANC, it's just been uncovered recently, she's employed as a researcher of Mutule House, and she's also the SRC chief president at the moment. And we can talk in more detail about all the intricacies, but I think what is happening at a number of campuses is that at the point that the student, the the Union Building March happened, it was clear that the ANC was shaken by the fact that this was a movement that was not a split from themselves, like the EFF and other things. This was a movement outside of what they could understand, and that they needed to make sure that the 0% was accepted and things were going to go back to normal. At the institutions where some of the students, through the student movement or even through political affiliation, had a different consciousness, they read this immediately as an instruction from the Tuli House by the state, down to the SRC and to the unions. I mean, now who is a SSCP union and a dysfunctional one at that, to say, this thing must end. And you guys must be, I mean, one of the things that people who work on social movements outside of student movements will know is that when people struggle, it's a violent, difficult struggle, and just at the point where you're going to win some basic rights, the ANC will swoop in, they'll have a t-shirt and a banner, and they'll claim the victory. So this is not, it's not unlike what happened at the Union Building, and that is why things got so violent. So there's all these questions about agent provocateurs and whatever. When you speak to the TMT students, they'll tell you, we have been stun grenaded, we have been shot, we're not scared of that. So for us to do what we did there, we've been doing this for years. So the middle class kids of Hertz were scared. They were more scared when the TUC guys wanted to light a match and burn their bus with them. But at the end of a 5-hour reflection at Hertz with hundreds of students, Hertz wanted to write an apology to TUC students and say, we are not at that point. We sing the struggle songs, but we haven't been victimized and brutalized like you guys have. So we're scared. So people are reading some of the things through the narrative of the ANC, which is a bit one-sided. Sorry, that was long. I don't even understand.
On the teaching and stuff, OS has been doing very similar stuff in terms of think tanks and idea hubs and learning. And I just wanted to know, like, at what point do you think the revolt will come to our curriculums properly? Because I know particularly at Stellenbosch, our history department, our English department is very, very whitewashed. I mean, if you look downstairs, there's a painting saying the battle of Andrina Street, which is live because it was an attack on Andrina Street by white men. I mean, there's things like someone was telling me the Sharpeville massacre is referred to as the Sharpeville incident. So the more I'm learning outside of the classroom, and I'm doing a humanities degree, which is the things that I should be learning, I'm learning with OS and in discussions like this, at what point is our frustration going to be enough that we say, okay, I'm done here, and put down our pens, because obviously that's not an option for everybody. So when will it escalate? Like, what are your thoughts on that?
I can tell you, I never knew it was going to escalate the way that it has in the last month. And one of the exciting and inspirational things is that no matter how much you know, you can never know for sure. So I wouldn't want to claim to do that. But you ask a very important question, I think. One of the things with RMF was that they were also reading radical pedagogical stuff, Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And so what they were recognizing was that and there's this argument between Gramsci and Freire and others about what you can do internal to a curriculum and to kind of traditional formal education. And so I think they were quite consciously talking about the fact that they needed to have a battle internal to formal schooling, but they also needed to create their own curriculum and their own. So they had those parallel things, and like you described, you're learning more about this outside of the humanities degree. It's learning differently, and those two things together are helping you. I can say the same thing for me. I learned a huge amount being in that educational process, more than I could have learned when I was in the various classes that I was in. The question around the revolt and the curriculum, I was talking to Stephen earlier about how people are talking about how students are emotional and they're bringing tactics into things and this is problematic, but they hide the fact that, in fact, academics' identity is seriously linked to what they research, who they choose, what concepts. And so when you're asking people to change their curriculum, you're not asking them only to change their curriculum. You're really asking them to look at their own positionality in relation to their things, and they don't want to do that because it's going to mean they're going to have to shift things. So, for example, at WITS, some of the things we've managed to do is we found the academics who are willing to engage us, and they've been at a postgraduate level in politics. There was a course on the genealogy of the non. That was 30 people, some honors and master's students, and then about 10 people auditing courses. So one of the means internal to this formal structure that's going to take a long time to change is to actually find academics that are going to let you audit their courses. And what you're finding is that the more conscious politically students, they're auditing across discipline. Some people they know where to find the courses, anthropology, some of politics, nothing in philosophy, sorry. So there's different ways that you're going to have to find a way to educate yourself in spite of and still pay the high fees to get this other thing that's important. So, I mean, I can't predict when, but the more students do that and the more they take responsibility for their own reading and thinking and discussion, I think it's going to end up. And then, of course, also resistance. The more people resist something, it's almost as if you're throwing gasoline on something and so I hope it's not going to go away. I hope we find a way to be able to have these conversations that don't exclude people such that people have to go to violence because they're not heard and they exclude all the time.
Let's take three. We had one there. Then we take four. Andrew, five. Okay. Can't get everyone in, but let's try and get, can you try and get us, you know, because okay. We've got time. But if we could just take five. So yeah, can the questions be quite compact so we can move on to the other questions? Okay.
Yeah, mine is going to be a little it relates to the question asked by Lucy, my level 3 boys. So this is more directed to the question that I think I'm not opposed to him. This is actually directed at that. So I wanted to know from your side, like, in terms of so yeah, I wanted to find out in terms of you know, accountability of academics, the kind of things the students have done at this. Because in Stellenbosch, we have a situation where somebody like Amanda Post will write an article in Burp, giving those racist people ammunition to say, open Stellenbosch is a violent room. Like, surely we can't have a situation where the public funds are being used to bring people who go out of their way. I'm not talking about somebody who made a mistake. I'm talking about somebody who's being responsible by using authority to silence us in the face of this thing. This is not a person who doesn't know about them. It's a person who knows these things are so true that she has direct knowledge of them. But as an academic, like as students working with you, because we can't let those people be responsible. And how can you go on to write an academic, you put it in your board and say, they are, look at them, black students, just like, you know, being rowdy and savages. Like, she's arming those people, and she's not here. She can respond, but
can we just say that we don't need whiteness to tell us the answer?
Yes.
I think that there was a whole. I have a space in Bergen every second week, and I have been an alternative voice in that space. So everybody who knows my work will know that. That article that you're referring to, as I wrote, and I said that when people use the word, what I said was to contextualize the responses on this campus to open Stellenbosch. And I was saying that there are people who say that there's a third force at work. But if we have that type of discourse, then it takes away the attention from the real issues. That was the first article. Then Kylie responded to me and said that I'm saying all kinds of things that I didn't say. Then I responded, and there is my article of last week is on the website where I've said why we should have sympathy, that why we should have solidarity with students with a Peace Must Fall in terms of the response to new capital, new liberal capitalism, in the sense that outsourcing is a new liberal capitalist practice that rents. That's what I was saying. So, you know, it's out there in the public space. I don't like this type of ambush because you don't know my work. You don't know what I've done for 25 years at this university as an agent of change.
So we've got four more questions.
Can we just, because that was quite a sensitive thing, let's not jump to the next question. So I think it's really important to ask questions when we want answers, and it's really important to give people the opportunity to answer even if we don't like the answer. But more than that, I'll use one example. At UCT, a lecturer from history wrote an article, Jessica Wold, I think her name was.
Rebecca.
She wrote an article that was critiquing Rosemary's Fall on the basis of, and it's a while ago now, but on the basis of having gone to one of their first mass meetings, and she'd spoken to one or two people. She wrote this long article that was quite problematic, and even some liberal people thought it was problematic. What Rosemary's Fall did was, they wrote the response that they did that article. So I think one of the things one can do, and I think students are like finding their voice, and in fact students are out arguing some of the people who are on academic staff about. So the point is to ask in public platforms and challenge people so that they think, but then also we have to write. We have to respond to what's going on. That's the best way that you can build an archive and an argument with someone to challenge the problematic stuff. And the point is, I don't know this person, but in the context of De Burger and Stellenbosch, I'm sure she gets shit, and she's not as conservative. So, I mean, we must also look at that context when we start talking more about who are allies in our institutions. So a person like this at Wits might not be an ally because we have an Amir Bereava and a Pashani Naidu and a Nguyen Kapitein, etc. But in your institution, you want to see where are your allies.
Okay.
We can have that conversation. So in terms of accountability, the way to hold people accountable when they're public intellectuals, you might not get a platform in Burka, but Facebook and there's a range of online platforms like Vanguard Magazine, all range of platforms where you can actually get the response out. And the online versions of papers are also very keen at the moment. I think the Argus had a five page spread of students, the Mail and Guardian and Student Voices. At the moment, people are looking to students because they're saying more critical and interesting things. So we need to do the work of taking up those spaces and actually doing that. It's a good question.
Okay, so we do forget the order now. Let's just keep work out the order organically. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Okay. The at the end of your presentation, you said RMF made some mistakes.
Yeah,
I did say mistakes. some people, like in from Stellenbosch, and even black people. They say stuff like, oh, I support what Open Stellenbosch does. I just don't like how they do it. You get what I'm saying? And when the feast thing happened, when we came together as students, this was a decolonization issue, right? So when we came together, even the students that were saying, I support Open Stellenbosch, but not it, students who didn't necessarily understand decolonization or transformation. Or patriarchy or whatever, we came together in one room and it was a bit messy at first, and then we got the head of things like that. But what I like what I'm trying to say is, I don't know if it gets the ball moving, but at the same time, educating the masses, like with this chairs thing, I think that's brilliant. But now, there's also a problem that you don't want to get stuck in a point where you are only doing educating my kids necessarily, or black people also that are not interested, where you actually want to make change. So how do you do that where you are keeping the ball moving, but you're getting people on this decolonization?
Do you want to take the cue, or do you
mind if I just respond?
Yes.
Let's have a conversation, because it's like, can't think of things. But what time must we enter?
You've stalled.
Sure.
Enough.
So first thing to say is, you point to a question that's something I struggle with. There's a lot of what they did here that I really expect and appreciate. But my job as a participant of Observer is both observing and trying to put distance between myself when I'm trying to do analysis, and then the difficult task when I'm actually participating in part of what's going on. So the point I'm raising is that actually everything that happened there was not okay. And the fact that people learned so much was because there were mistakes. Mm-hmm. And there's a number of examples almost in every conversation, because the conversation, I was trying to describe the form or the frame of the conversation that allowed those mistakes to happen, and those mistakes to be learning or conscientizing moments. For the people who are having the conversation, and for the people who are just witnessing, they're just part of it. They're not even talking. So for me, the your very important question about how you both keep that consciousness into political education work going, as well as struggle with the more kind of structural stuff and what's happening on the ground, I think we, at the moment, we're not managing to do that, because people, I think, in how the month has unfolded and in all the different power dynamics that are at play, I think the educational program or the conscientization stuff has either dropped off the program, or it's become very small for the people who are intimately involved in continuing, because other people are doing exams and some people are saying, whoa, someone burned something, now I'm not involved. So there is all of that, and I think that question is key. I don't have the answer yet. I think it's got a lot to do with this idea of strategy and tactics, like what is really important to do right now, what can we retreat on and say that that's going to be next year. I don't think we have that yet. I think a lot of students are still shocked that the last month has happened in the way that it has. And I think a lot of people are a lot more traumatized than people realize from being shot at and in prison and all of those things. So I don't think we've got that balance right, but I don't think it's something that we won't figure out. So we're making mistakes. But the point is, if we continue to reflect about what's happening, what went well, what didn't, then I think we learn from it and we don't make the same mistakes again. And at this point, nobody has been seriously hurt or killed, which is in fact a good thing. And even as some of these tactics have had to move into some violence, I mean, I think we're still at the stage that is pre-revolutionary. And so we have the possibility to set up things now for later down the line, and the educational and the reflection question is key to that.
Yes.
Liana, I want to ask you a very difficult question, which I ask myself. The fees issue is essentially has been described as a middle class issue. The insourcing issue has been described as a working class issue. Now, one of the reasons why I suppose it's taken the public by storm in the media is because these two issues have been quite cleverly combined by mostly white journalists. Not. The question is a long-term question. I know that you've been intimately involved with student movement. not only in prose, but in its form, but also with fees and the source in question. I'd like to know from you what you are looking for. What, as a student leading yourself, where would you like to direct the struggle? And what coordinates, what political coordinates are we looking at in the future? And one of the reasons why I'm asking the question is because I think politics is moving beyond organizational forms. That is why we're seeing people ignoring the SRCs, even the Senates. So I'd like to know what your understanding is of where we're heading to politically, what you're hoping to achieve. Not ultimately, because I don't think we can answer ultimate questions. We can answer process questions.
Mm.
So if you can reflect on that, I'd appreciate
it. I mean, the first thing is that this idea of leadership is up for grabs. People are really not keen on this idea of leaders, in the sense that they've had experience over the last 20 years of leaders who don't listen to them, who aren't accountable, who don't come back, who don't know how to have a conversation. So I think you're right around the organizational structures, and people are trying to figure out a different way to organize. But going back to how you started the question, I don't think that the relation between fees, because I don't think fees is only a middle-class issue. I think what we've realized is that the demographics at certain universities has changed so much that it is a lot more mixed than merely a middle-class question. And I think that NSFAS, because of its, NSFAS has given somewhat envy to people, and then it's been a corrupt and problematic institution, and so it's failed. So in a sense, there is a much more mixed demographic. And through this struggling of fees, we realize that WITS, for example, we have food gardens now. There are food banks. Students are actually not eating. They're sleeping in 24-hour labs. So it is in fact a working class issue. And they, through some good programs, badly implemented maybe by government, there's a lot more mix in the student population. That's the first thing. The second thing is that I don't think it was cleverly combined by white journalists. I think as people started to speak about decolonization and take seriously, Fanon says very clearly in one of his chapters, besides the fact that it's a violent process, that people lose things, they feel offended by this big shift in things. He also says that you have to, in this process, put the last first. The last shall be first and the first shall be last. So when people sit and we sit at university and we say, okay, at our institution, who's last here? It's not poor black students who are getting an education. It's workers who are outsourced, who have been working for 15 years and earning 2,000 a month. So that's how people become, or able to, under the decolonize, and not just the long-standing outsourcing issue, rally behind workers. That's how we, I mean, I think if I were to imagine what individual leadership is, then it is something about being able to tie your fate to someone less often. So, for example, someone who's sitting in a research institute, an academic, if they can't make decisions and think from the position of a departmental head who's got admin and teaching and publishing, then that person's not leading. They're worried about themselves and they're in their situation and they don't have an understanding of what they do, and they make a choice not to shift that. So for me, that's how those two things get linked quite easily. By working class kids and workers, but also by more middle class people who are wanting to tie their fate with someone else, someone who's not as fortunate. So in terms of my hope for all of this, I want outsourcing to end. It's a terrible practice. There's some very simple ways that one can try and do that. And in the WITS case, it is a simple case of as these contracts expire, we're going to insource people. We're going to get a task team who can think properly through the finances and through everything else. But strategically, the finances shouldn't drive that question. It's a principal decision around a dehumanizing system. And our university management argued it the other way around with us for a long time. And it was only at the negotiation table where we continued to have this debate with them that they've got it. It's actually not the case of is it feasible. It's the case of if this is a decolonized public African university that we're trying to imagine, organizational forms, what is leadership, what is the curriculum, all of that, you have to lead with the principal, and then you find the money afterwards. And so I don't have the answers to all the organizational forms. What I do know is that the powerful and the powerful forms at the moment are going to backlash against us, as our SRCs are doing, as the unions are doing, in a whole range of ways. And the ones who are ANC inclined have funding to do it. They have money, they have the media, and they have a whole range of things. So the backlash is going to be harsh, and it's going to be ongoing. But I think we need to just keep experimenting with different ways and holding power to account to try and shift things.
That's very interesting. I mean, I think that last point, I'm not going to say much, is quite key. The university is a space where you can reimagine something different, because there's a corporate world just out there that can take it as naturalized that you outsource, right? Costs. But if we are going to let universities mimic that business model, we've lost a lot. So I think for me, that is one of the most exciting aspects, the many exciting aspects of the student movement, but that can move way beyond the university in terms of challenging the overall view of the universe. Okay, so you've been waiting a long time, Okay, so let's get the three
interstitial questions. So, hi, my name is Marvin. I've been trying to get my head around how we can create alternatives. I think it's an old story that governments are not gonna charter, you know, create the future that we want, and so on and so forth. I know I've been trying to learn from other cultures and other people that have, other groups of people that have started to kind of, create their own. So, for example, when the apartheid government, they decided they're going to get rid of one property. So they decided that in order for us to do this, we are going to create the 8K TV, whatever, however you say, Afrikaans, and we are going to create residences next to schools, and then I mentioned that everyone goes to residences, and everyone knows their culture, that everyone, you know, can study in their culture. So, like, what are some of these key kind of key society building, new alternative creating world kind of things that we can start getting our heads around, and we as Black people or as people of color can start putting into place as alternatives for the current discussions, you know, because I mean politics and the current discussions are going to carry on, but essentially we need another world. We need things to look different, we need practices to be different, there needs to be something else. What are some of the things that you've seen and learned from other cultures that have kind of flipped the tables?
I'm a student chair. I just want us to like be honest with ourselves. Who are we decolonizing for? Because it's something like what you said with the BIT students going to UT and how they said they're not ready at that level. And I feel like that's sort of problematic that, yes, you can write a letter and great, but they've been going through this like for years now. I mean, the chief has been protesting since I was in primary school. So, I mean, you get to a level of frustration. Then I got here, I'm from Pretoria, and I told people that, when people are telling me that RNF is so radical, and I'm part of Pakistan now, so that it's so radical, and that they're not radical. And we also have to be honest with ourselves. The reason is they've made such like leaps and stuff is because they have white people also around them. And like, I don't know how it is. It's like Stellenbosch white people. I don't know, they've got white interests. So like the universities that are protected by like white people. So the fact that we're making like steps, who are we making the steps for? Because if TUT and them have been doing this for long, I mean, we at the moment, to be honest, are like, if we're going to be honest with ourselves, we're at an access problem. There aren't enough Black people in the United States, so we're at an access problem. Now, if we're going to start talking about decolonization, the first people we should be looking at is places like that, like 2T and Wusu and those. Why haven't they decolonized? And like, are we really taking decolonization seriously? because then those places are ones where you could actually, the model is already ready, because they have black spaces like already, but yet like no one listens. So what would you call it for? The middle class or like?
I want to make 2 points. The first is sort of related to what Kara was saying. So the context of Stellenbosch is the fact that the political conversations that have been happening on campus are very new. There hasn't been very much robust political conversation in the past. And so it would make sense that the criticisms levied at Open Stellenbosch is the fact that they're lacking in terms of robustness, that they're a bit tentative in terms of their conversations and that sort of thing. And that's primarily because of the fact that if you do have a very sort of robust conversation about transformation or decolonization, you're going to face very heavy backlash from the not just the university, but from the society in which Stellenbosch exists and that sort of thing, right? So in that regard, if Stellenbosch ever gets to a place where they're able to have a very sort of robust and like progressive conversation about decolonization, then is it worth our while to sort of look at what universities would even look like in terms of, you know, what form they would take in the decolonized sense. So my idea is that like what Roads Must Fall, BSM, and Open Stellenbosch have been doing in terms of interactive like think tanks that have become sort of one of the mode ways of like teaching and learning and that sort of thing. Like the idea that people are able to interact on that kind of level. So that's question slash comment number one. Secondly, Zuma's timing in terms of buying that 4 billion rand jet is really off. It's terribly off. Because, I mean, there were students protesting about, okay, we need money to subsidize student fees and that sort of thing. And the response from the government is like, you know, we don't really have much money and that sort of thing. And then a 4 billion rand jet gets bought and that sort of thing. So, like, it's offish like that. And we all know that the powers that be are the bastions of coloniality in South Africa, because of the fact that their conversation is one about transformation in terms of rearranging people's place on the hierarchy, right? That's what transformation is. Decolonization is getting rid of the hierarchy altogether, right? So with regards to that, when students are shot at and arrested and branded as criminals and tear gassed and charged with treason for holding their government accountable, that's a direct attack on people's civil liberties, because the entity you're trying to hold you're trying to hold accountable is not allowing you to hold it accountable. So the question is, like, what do we then do? Like, what are we supposed to do if we want to hold the entities accountable for X, Y, Z, but they're not allowing us to?
Look, I was asking my questions. okay. Maybe let me start there.
Okay.
Because it's fresh. So I'm of the opinion that people have a different role to play in the struggle, in the city.
Okay.
So this idea that, I think there must be criticism of Open Stellenbosch where people are making decisions and taking stances that are not progressive. This idea of who's radical and who's progressive, and it's a complicated one. I don't believe that just burning something is radical.
Yes. Yeah.
That's the first thing. So it's not that TUT was burning things. No, no, of course there's a context. Of course there's a context, and we must understand that. No, no, I get that. I'm appreciative of what TUT did that day. If they didn't, it would have been a very expensive PR exercise, and we would have all been part of being compromised by our government, who had a nice show and thousands of people. So I'm glad they did it. I was there. I wasn't right in front. Because it was my father trained people to use guns under apartheid. So I know how to use a gun. I've had all of that stuff. But when I'm there, it's a whole other thing when you as an older person are confronted with this. So the point is, I have no doubt that Open Stellenbosch is gonna get more radical. For people to be saying to you, you're not radical enough, we dismiss you, you're not part of it, I don't agree with that, and I will tell my RMF comrades that when they ask me. The point for me is that there is a space, a different space for people in the struggle, and we must not burn bridges with people. Some people write fantastically radical stuff and they can't throw a petrol bomb. You know, we must see what people can do, and we must, if they want to contribute to the struggle, they must contribute. But what I don't think we must do is,
I don't think when TUT is burning stuff or when people, I mean, I get that you say, is it you that said RMF is not that radical? Literally, they threw a water bottle at their vice chancellor and there's now a civil war.
Yeah.
People are like crazy like that. So my point is that the contexts are different and there's ways that we can learn from one another. But I don't think it's helpful in building a movement to disregard people because of their radicalness or not radical. That's the first thing. Let's not get into dialogue. I'm still asking this question. The other thing is, if you read Fanon, he was clear. You and me are going to sell out the revolution. His whole chapter on national consciousness was, do not trust the black middle class. So let us be honest about that. And let us be self-reflective of it. Because this idea that, so let me put myself here. I have a white partner. I'm in a lesbian relationship. I have an adopted daughter from Soweto. So this idea that I can separate easily who's an ally and who's not an ally in this thing is a complicated thing. I'm also doing stuff that maybe people mustn't know about that's going to forward the struggle. But I'm going to talk to my white partner maybe about it, and I'm not going to not do it because she has a particular skin color. I'm also not going to trust my associate president who comes in a particular skin color, but it's something I've so many times.
Yeah.
So we have to be careful of people who want privilege and power, especially the ones who do it unconsciously, because they are not going to help us. But I don't think a simple argument around black is right and white is wrong. I mean, we are living in a country where we have a black government. We have political power. And they were working against us. So, getting rid of hierarchy. I mean, we all have to struggle with this thing. Getting rid of hierarchy, I mean, I don't think I'm an anarchist necessarily in that sense, where everyone must do it. We definitely need some forms of structure and some forms of communicating with majorities of people. And there are people who've worked with this better than South Africa. People have had meetings with thousands where they have particular types of facilitation styles and how you do it. We must learn from that. So going from RMF that was small to WITS, where we had 3,000 people in a meeting, and we had men's race descending, not wanting to talk, they want to sing, and they want to walk behind Matsebo Dlamini. It was difficult to deal with. But we must find ways to. So this idea that we must just sort of point everything open and that the working class is just sort of going to not be violent and not be racist and not racist, sexist, homophobic. I mean, it's not true. We have to actually be engaging and thinking seriously about alternatives, not merely getting rid of the hierarchy and not replacing it with something that's going to be better. Sorry, that was your question. Then, who are we decolonizing for? I mean, in my understanding, decolonization is, and this is the other thing, we need to get more serious about understanding what people mean by decolonization. It's not one thing. It's an intense concept and we need to be working out what that means. So when we decolonization, I mean, if you use Fanon, he's saying that the main move of colonization was othering people. It's making some, and spatially separating people out in ways that we are, because we still see in the Western world. So there's something around trying to work against that. And there's something about that in my own life that has been very challenging around being intimately involved with someone who's very othered from me. So I think it's Audre Lorde that says the best place where you can do hard work is when you get intimately involved with someone who's not maybe the same gender as you, same race, etc. And this is the hardest situation you're going to find yourself in, and it's going to make you ask the most difficult questions. So decolonization is about moving against this idea of the other in both directions. From the point of view of someone who has felt secondary or second to whiteness, because I grew up in apartheid, even though I grew up in a radical home, there's deep stuff that one works through. In the same way, white people have got to work through the opposite of that. So for me, it is this question of othering and how we take on, and I'm not arguing, let me just be clear now, because I don't want just to come back to me in my meetings where they're saying, hey, it's telling what you said. What I'm not saying is that there mustn't be spaces where people, to use a bad word, that politics has messed up caucus. So for example, in RMF, part of why it's strong is because there's a LGBTI caucus, is because there's a women's caucus, there's a men's caucus. This is not to create distraction and to work against each other. At some point, the men had to withdraw, and they needed to go talk to each other, because literally they were not managing being leaders or being in a space with transsexual women. They were not managing it. And then there were some of them who were trying to have conversations with each other about it. But in a plenary space, it's difficult. If you are conscious of a feminist man, you're not going to take up as much space. So when your brother who isn't conscious is talking shit, you yourself are compromised, because you're not going to now want to resolve this as two men fighting, because that's blind into patriarchy. So what happens is they withdraw into a caucus so that you have a safe space to speak with people who understand you. This is where a black safe space is important. We shouldn't argue against it. But the point is that there has to be some point where we come back together again and people bring their consciousness back into. And that's not to say that then the people who have the material resources, the education, whatever, are automatically the leaders. That consciousness must come back into the conversation and into thinking about how we redo hierarchies, such that the same people who are privileged are not the ones who end up leading everything. So, I mean, it's a difficult balance. We're all struggling with this thing. The question of alternatives, and I mean, that starts to speak about that. Alternatives I'm imagining as caucuses. So, okay, maybe not. But there are spaces where various communities have managed through self-organization to help themselves out of a difficult situation. I mean, I'm being very vague.
So, for example, the education thing, right? The apartheid government said, Afrikaans government said, okay, cool. We're going to take all academic material and turn it into Afrikaans. We're going to teach every single Afrikaans person. Look, it's still not much. You know what I mean? You can come and you can learn any single discipline in your language. You know? That is something that transformed the Afrikaans community into a place where now it's one of the vehicles in which they use to eradicate poverty for. So I'm speaking about alternatives that are that extreme. Like, what is it that we need to put in place and say, okay, let's talk about decolonization, but at the end of the day, then schooling is going to look like this, or this is how housing is going to look, or this is how land is going to look. Like, what are some of the key things?
And you say alternative because you don't think that should be strategically staked interventions around language policy.
Yeah.
So you think it has to happen outside? I think it's a combination.
Sorry. Do you think that, because your example is
I know that. But I think there's some space for the alignment of the two. But I also think that there's a huge part to be played. I mean, there's a lag issue there. And I think that there's a huge part to be played by non-state driven initiatives. I mean, some of us are going to go into maybe working for the state, but some of us are not going to go into the state. So what would that look like?
Look, I mean, just very briefly, because I think that's a big question. For me, I don't want to be paying money to a state that goes into the billions and then they're using it on private jets.
Yes.
So I think it's all these things. I think we must hold our state accountable, and we must. Some, and this goes back to the question of everyone has a different role. So I don't think it's useful just blanketly saying all PYA, all SASCO, all ANC people are bad.
No,
missing an opportunity there, because there are people who want to fight from the inside. And historically, that has always happened. Some people have gone inside to the state, some people have gone outside, some people have created alternatives. I think there's space for all of those things. I wouldn't say alternatives should be the only way or the better way, but we need to build self-reliance, hold the state accountable.
Okay. Unless there's a final press effort, we'll have two more questions.
Three, four.
Three more, that's it. Okay. Could you introduce yourself?
My name is Melissa. I'm Secretary of the SYDA. Lesbian gay.
What I would like to know, what I've been reading a lot about is the erasure of women and non-binary individuals, and also the erasure of LGBTQIPA plus individuals in the movement, and also the erasure of disabled individuals, those who are do not identify as able-bodied, and the way that a lot of people do not feel that they are included in the revolution. There is obviously a lot of movement. I've read a few papers that have been, I saw a paper where Jodie Williams was, I'm sure the people, yeah, have read the article, but there's a lot of this inclusion, and I was wondering what do you think are practical steps to make the revolution more inclusion? What are some of the practical steps, and also what are the things which student societies such as Les Bi Gay can start becoming more involved in these revolutions? I'm going to use the word because I believe it's a revolution.
So the revolution is very late. And as actually Chairperson of Elsinore at the Nigerian College, and I've been given a double position of to silence us, of being the president of the Cultural College of Students. I have worked before, and in 2013, I decided to go back to school and do agriculture because I want to farm. Only to find that when I got to the agricultural college, that what is being done is a joke for a lack of a better way. So we started from there with the youth, and what continued was particularly in Elsenberg. I find that continuously Elsenberg has managed to have about close to 90% of white African speaking students in a sector that go out to the sector which is agriculture, that is the least transformed in the country. And we are, there's still no way of knowing how that has happened until now. And in 2013, we found that a lot of money is being paid to bring agricultural colleges together for sports. But there isn't anything that speaks to the curriculum. But when you sit down and look at the curriculum and you look at the people that come, particularly people that don't come from farming backgrounds, which will be black people, they go out and they do not get, they don't do anything. They can only be extension officers, but they don't go to farm. And that in the light of this failing land reform and all of this in the country. Now, we then stopped. You were talking about the meeting that you had with Minister Zamande, where students were being sidelined. We hijacked in 2013 a meeting like that in Free State with Mamike Kabata, who was the MEC of agriculture there. We said, we don't want money spent in sports. We want to talk about agriculture as the youth. As you're saying, land reform is failing and the rural development is failing because young people are apathetic, they don't want to get into agriculture. And we were just saying, okay, so what do you want? First, they said, we need a structure to talk at a national level. It was only this year, in June 1st, that structure was elected after a number of times we had to camp in parliament to get the attention of people. Now, our challenge is we are small in numbers. And as the student population, now you guys may have about 500-600 students. But of those, you'll find that less than about 80 or so, less, non-white, they are black. Yes. But African, I'm sorry. Yeah. You find that is the situation, and of those people are concerned with, hey, I want to go out, let me get my qualification and go to me. So, but you spoke about, first when you were talking, there was this Chicano boy in was being interviewed at SAFM and then phoned you.
Yes.
And you spoke on an issue that touched me, the issue of land. That when we talk about education and linking it to land, agricultural colleges are where we need to start, or how do we go forward from there? What can you say with regards to that. How can we be able to use even the structures that they've given us, because there's now this structure of the representative of all agricultural colleges that I'm said to be a president of, but there's no funds or anything of actually trying, but we want to use that structure to actually draw attention to land reform and participation of young people in that.
That's a great question.
Hi, I'm Vanessa. I'm from this department. Contributed or not, and also just a bit of reflection on whether or not is there also a power dynamic there, and how does it play out? I mean, obviously, if you have a PhD, you can't ignore that you have a PhD, right? So how do you not drown out the voices of the students?
Okay, we're going to stop there. So I think one of the things that academics that have been supportive and helpful have done is that they've firstly listened to students and they've supported some of what students have been doing, which is it's kind of an arbitrary thing. But more and more what's happened at WITS now, very recently, so we have, there is an academic unit, it's quite conservative. They've only marched once, and they marched around their own fee increases. And they managed to shut the university down a few years ago, which was great, because they were organizing. But what happened around the last 3 weeks is that, quite organically, a group of staff formed a WhatsApp group, but they did it in relation to, so it was loosely organized, in relation to a protest policy that we've been working on at this, because it's an old thing of our management to discipline leaders and put them into disciplinary procedures, etc. So this policy suggests a witnessing group. So not witnessing on behalf of management, but witnessing as an outsider and taking account of what's going on. So of course this policy was post-October 2015. So we didn't think, the people who developed it didn't think of marching to the Thule House without permission. And now you're a staff member, and now you've got to witness. So the point is that this particular group started in response to a policy. So there were people on there that were very about policy and was protest like, the rules. And then they get chucked in a situation where there's a call that says, the cops are going to fire in 5 minutes. Please come. And people come running. Some people have never been to a march. They put on their burps. And the students go, who the fuck are you with your books? We didn't organize marshals. Who are you witnessing on behalf of? Management? Who? Like, so staff were put in a situation for the first time, some of them who are not part of studies, who were going, they don't want us here. And we're going, no, it's not that I want you. Either stand on the side and we'll be clear with them that you are witnessing so that we have an independent account, which was actually helpful the first day of the march where that guy's car got turned over. Because he literally tried to kill some students. Mm. And people chased him. And they took him out of the car before they turned the car over. And they gave him a call. So had the staff not been there to witness that account, it would have been, you know, a problem for a lot of the students. But what it did to staff is it made them realize that they can't stand with the book on in these issues. And some staff are much more willing to jump between the cops when they're about to fire, and we had a number of those situations that were very helpful when staff did that. And then there's also the fact that now that group then had a meeting to discuss what was going on, and you heard very clearly who the different roles in the struggle, who the people were who wanted to witness. They're not going to march and get shot and whatever. But then when the next Senate meeting happened, that group met to caucus. So some people were in a caucus, have never been in a caucus, and they're like, okay, why are we here? What are we? And people are saying, we're going into a conservative Senate. They've just made these decisions. The students are probably going to disrupt. What are we as staff going to do? And then the humanities met, because they are more progressive than the conservative Senate. But the small group that went to the humanities were like, actually, our humanities is not that radical. So the point is, it's multiply layered, and as people get involved, you are compromised in a way that you have to ask these questions, and you have to say what you think, and you have to, in the moment where they're going to shoot, you must now make your decision. And the point is just that, from the student's perspective, the people who are willing to commit more and be there are being honest, and those are people of all genders, views, whatever. And the people who are only prepared to go so far, that's also great. But there is a battle to be waged, so I don't know when academics are going to actually wake up to all of this more seriously, because if you look at one of the posters on the building to the union, the student union building march, autonomy must form. University autonomy must form. This was also raised by various SASCO people from the floor at the summit. So there's clearly a move, and we've seen what the reforms to the higher education bodies, the minister wants more powers. We've also seen at WITS, there's normally up to 5 government officials on council. There's always only been 3, now there's 5. So the point is, academics have a fight. And one day when you want to ask students to march with you and workers in relation to academic autonomy, they're going to say, where were you when we were marching? So I think there's a process of academics realizing we also have a role to play to answer to the state, and we also have a role to play to answer to senates and councils that are detached from. I mean, the Senate is supposed to be the highest academic governance body, but if you see what they do, in response to students, it's really problematic. So I think there is a role to play, and people must self-organize, and in the same way that some students have held other students accountable, academics must do that. And you, at WITS, you very quickly see now who's who. There's a very volatile situation around who's saying people are. So it's interesting. It's not only between students. The agricultural college thing is huge. I mean, it's been so quiet, in a sense, that I don't know, SOCs are not talking about it, student movements haven't realized it. Now that we do, of course, the best thing to do is to join up. Because the minute you do that, I mean, a lot of people have said to me, the land thing is key, but you must be strategic about the land. Build your movement before they break it. So build your movement. I mean, of course, the land is the deep coming up. It's a key question that many of us want to struggle around. But if that is our main rallying call, strategically, over the long run, it might be a silly call, because there are also a lot of middle class people who don't want to give up their time. There's a whole range of consciousness work that has to happen before that. So I think we should organize and join up. And I think that question is the key one, and that's the one that capital is really, not only through the state, but if you look at private security in this country, it is highly protected by security forces, private security. So, I mean, when you're asking the question of like revolution, where it's going to get nasty, that's going to be the place that's going to really go down. So I don't think it's your analysis is wrong. It's spot on, but we must be strategic about how we discuss it and how we use that as part of conceptualization. The sport thing is huge. I mean, I'm an ex-sports person, like seriously. And if you look at what sport did in the role in the transition, I mean, I think the ANC understood that it needed to use what it would have imagined to be negotiables, like sport. But if you look more seriously at how sports used now, I mean, in 2022, when the question of decolonization is raging, Durban has won the bid to host the Commonwealth Games. They won it because they were competing against themselves, because nobody else wants to host a big event like that, because it's going to bankrupt us.
Yeah.
But your thing around distraction, like we're going to put money into that thing and people are going to be distracted and it's going to be marketing and all that. So under apartheid, sport, I learned my political consciousness through sport. So the same way that some people are using sport to do whatever they're doing, we need to use sport to get young people interested and then ask the hard questions around land and other things. So I think these are mechanisms that one uses in struggle, and it's quite clear that the powers that be know this as well. So we have to have our own plans around it. And then, lesbian gay. There is definitely, I mean, the RMF situation, I'll just use it as an example, and I hope I'm not speaking out of turn. But there has been a serious split in how, I mean, their trans, queer, and female were powerful, as powerful, even more powerful, I would say, than some of the male leaders. And that has shifted significantly. And I think that's got to do with a whole range of things. But in the RMF situation, where in fact you have seen the trans collective, Patriarchy Must Fall, and various campaigns or sub movements to the RMF movement, I think that's been good. But how people have dealt with the last month has been different. And so I think when people are traumatized by police and arrest and other things, they deal with things differently. I've seen a whole range of male comrades who have gotten a lot more aggressive, and aggressive defensively, right? So much more triggered and much more scared in a way, whereas the female leaders have disappeared. So they're not coming to marches. And there's a whole range of reasons. I mean, as LGBTIQ plus people, we understand what it means to struggle, because it's a different kind of norm that you're working against. And as women, patriarchy is often not spoken about as much as race and class, but I mean, it is a difficult situation. So I think the reason why people have withdrawn and stories are being told differently is different depending on the context. And I think we need to find a way to support students who have been not only marginalized through their positionality, but through the trauma of being arrested. So a couple of female leaders were arrested and spent the day and were individually interrogated, and they're struggling to recover from that. So that's one of the things. In the WITS context, our female leaders, because both our SRC chairpersons are women, or identifying as women, it has been a really bad photo op for feminism, because a lot of people are saying, is this what feminism is? And we're going, this is not what, this is deployment, this is not feminism. And yet, the people are wanting, the media in particular, wanting to portray female leaders, and it's unfortunate that the ones that are getting portrayed are the ones who are connected to media, and so are getting front page of the New York Times, front page of a whole range of magazines, front page of a whole range of newspapers. So, I mean, where women have been presented as leaders, it's been problematic, and where people have disappeared, there's been problems there. So I think it's a very important question, and we have to try and stay aware of the fact that we are hurt and traumatized, and we have to figure a way forward from there.
Thanks very much, Leanne. Thank you all for coming.